find some learning of emotional intelligence, right? So this is where I want you to be very active, very proactive. I'm not bringing here any theory, any context, but I'm trying to bring a practical, real life orientation to what is emotional intelligence and how it has to be or it is associated with our life. Right? So don't expect any theories, but I expect much of your participation, your promptness to, interact so that we derive to the ultimate learning with which I've drafted this entire presentation. So when I refer to anything which is holistic, okay, when I refer to something which is holistic, especially in context to emotional intelligence, it is something which is not aligned to something outside, but it is something that is aligned, something that is holistic within yourself. We live in a world, okay, we spend our majority of life shifting ourselves continuously from one world to another world, isn't it? There is an external world of incidents, of people, of opportunities, of struggles, challenges. And there is an internal world which resides within us, which is where we spend majority of our time, knowingly, unknowingly, in this big sphere that we hold within ourselves, that big world which exists in ourselves, is something which is untrapped. It is untrapped. Whatever education we have been in our school days or even in our college, like before 3 years when I came across this particular topic that came under developmentary skills part 2 under GTU curriculum, I was the faculty who proposed to the university that I want to take this subject, because since past 7 years I have been working on life skills program. This is one of my benchmark program which talks about different life skills which is important. And in absence of life skills, whatever education we may have, whatever degrees we may have, the life seems to be incomplete. And emotional intelligence is one of the center aspect to all these life skills, right? So the holistic approach, I just want to clarify this to the audience, that the holistic approach which I'm going to talk about is not something which is outside, but it is something that completes us within and what is existing within us. So this is a huge world of emotions, thoughts, right? Of our own identity, of our soul, of our spirit, of our meaning, of our existence, our life, which we hardly take time, which is hardly taught to us how to reach out to ourselves. Right, whenever we face any difficulties, any problems, any issue, we always land out for the help, we seek out for the help, support from the external people, right, from the people who are in the outside world. But each of our problems has some definite solutions which is within us. And if you are emotionally intelligent, you can create that relationship with yourself. Right, you would be knowing now that emotional intelligence has one of its important, element, that is self-awareness. So if we establish that relation very right within ourself, every other relation will become meaningful, it will become effective, and the life will have its own opportunities and beauty to unfold with us. Right, so holistic orientation is orientation of ourself within the world in which, right, we hardly go and we hardly visit. Right, so what I will be taking you through is how emotional intelligence is associated with our life and with our birth cycle. How emotional intelligence shapes and builds, and what is the connection of this emotions with our inner persona, that is our inner personality, which is again never taught. Right, we are more groomed externally, but hardly the syllabus, the curriculums are there, which actually makes us realize about our core, our inner persona. Right, this is not something that can be taught by anybody, but definitely a true mentor, a true coach, a true guru will always ignite you the ways through which you can reach to your inner persona. You can identify that uniqueness of your existence. And then we will be identifying the ways through which we align our emotions with our brain, or what is the association between the brain and emotion, right? Majority of the decisions which we make in our life are either through our heart or through our mind, right? So what is the relation? Is there any association or not? That is what we will be seeing further. And ultimately, when you leave this particular 2 hours with me, right, I really want that there should be a definite relation that you establish with yourself at the closure of this 2 hours. So this is what I'm trying to bring forward. Okay. So this presentation which I'm bringing, and this initial context to the presentation which I'm bringing, is very, very core to my heart. What do you understand with this particular image? What does this image reflect? You can unmute yourself and you can let me know.
Maybe the bond between a child and a mother.
A bond between a child and a mother. What else? Yachna, right?
Yes.
Mother thinking and dreaming of the child.
Okay, mother thinking and dreaming of a child. Okay, what else? My presentation was too fast.
From our birth to the current life.
Okay. Ma'am, you have gone much ahead, much far. Recalling your own childhood memory, mother at job, thinking of a kid. Okay, that is something we all associated a lot. So this is where, you know, I talk about, I take this image to reflect a motherhood, a parenthood, which is planned, right? So we become parents, we embrace motherhood or fatherhood in two ways. One, we are planning our family, we are visualizing our family at right point of time, right? We want to have a family. So when it comes to a mother who is thinking of giving birth to a child, right, who is thinking of giving birth to a child, the time when she's putting that conscious efforts, that conscious energy that she's driving to bring the child into existence, is where she takes accountability of looking after herself. How well she is in terms of her physical body, in terms of the nutrition, in terms of bones, in terms of health, in terms of everything which will be required to nurture a life within. Okay? So here is a conscious effort through which a mother is planning, a lady is planning to become a mother. In this entire process, she is very conscious about what she thinks, right? Because whatever she thinks is something which is will be impacting the child within her. What is she eating? How is she eating? When is she eating? What is the energy that she is giving to the food? Because this food is not just going to nurture her, but the child within her. What is she talking about? Whom she is talking with? How she is talking? She is at most taking care of herself in terms of what she thinks, what she eats, what she does, how she walks, how she talks, what is she listening? Is she listening? Every positive thing, every good thing which is nurturing her, that positivity, those thought processes are reaching to the child in the womb, right? I hope you all would be aware that a child who is not born, somewhere in the 9th month of the pregnancy in the womb of mother, the child is able to experience around 80,000 thoughts. And who is responsible for these thoughts is again the mother and the environment around her. So she will always try to keep herself in the right mood, in the right temperament, happy, so that those happiness, those happy vibration nurtures the child in the best possible way. She makes sure that she reads the best things that can imbibe those good virtues, those good thoughts to the child, because she is not just now living her life, but she is responsible for the new life, for the new life that is nurturing within her. The moment the child is born, the most beautiful moment, the child, right, when it is born, be it a mother, be it a father, the first time when you hold this child in your hand, what do you promise? What do you promise? You promise them to give them the best possible, right? Best life, best opportunities, more of the warmth, love, right? Best of what you can offer is something that you promise the child. You start nurturing the child with everything that you have within you. And in case if you don't have it, you try to imbibe it, because now you are a parent. You owe that responsibility. So a child who is there in the womb of mother, the experiences that the mother and the father or the family creates for the child who is not even born, the responsibility which you seek for that 9-month child which is not even born, this is the same tenure which we spend with our students, isn't it? So if one child makes us so sensible, so much caring, so much nurturing, so much in terms of, you know, our own awareness of what we eat, what we do, how do we speak, how do we sleep, everything, we become so conscious in those 9 months. This 9 months is the exact period we spend with each batch of students that we have in our college, isn't it? Right? Our students are hardly with us for 9 months. And they are in huge number. It's not just the one child responsibility that we are holding on ourselves, isn't it? Right? There is a batch of 100 students, 210 students, don't know the number of students to whom we are responsible. This is the sense of ownership I want you to have when it comes to your own emotional intelligence. Because we become the role model of our students. So something that we don't have, we need to imbibe that, because we are showcasing ourselves as somebody who is idealist to our students, right? So as we promise the child, same we have to do with ourselves, right? There is a beautiful bond that is beyond the curriculum that we share with our students, right? Our students, right, we are not here just to complete a syllabus or a curriculum. We are here to give something that they will be holding with themselves whenever they feel any challenge in their life, be it at the workplace, be it in their personal life, be it in the social sphere where they are working. This is something that we share. This is something with which we ignite these kids, these students. And this is what has made me in the education. Right. I mean, it was very difficult for me to decide when I thought I want to start with my consultation, because I was not able to, you know, get out of that role of motherhood, which I had always played for my students. And even today, I am there in touch with them with different programs. Right. So we are the one who holds that responsibility of nurturing the next generation from coming. I mean, bringing them out to that happy quotient and, you know, all that is limiting them in their world, we hold that responsibility to shift that world for them. And that starts when we start liberalizing ourselves from our past, our, you know, bondage of feelings, right? So unlocking the potential of your students, of our students, starts when you start unlocking yourself. And that is where whenever you want to give something, you need to have it, you need to create it first. If it does not exist, you need to create it. And this creation is shifting you, right, from all those questions, all those things which is not giving you that clarity in your life, to reaching out to the heights, to the ultimate goals that you decide for yourself, be it in the form of degree, be it in the form of job, be it in the form of your own entrepreneurship, be it for doing something for your society or for your nation, right? So this child with that question mark and with that one drop of tear is something that is still alive in us. Even after all this year, somewhere we have not released ourselves from the past emotions, which is still holding us, which is still not allowing us to progress. And somewhere, you know, that is something which is limiting us to offer what we could offer, contribute what we can contribute in our real life. So this is what I'm trying to bring today with all of you, right? Shift yourself just from a curriculum to something which adds more realistic meaning to your students. And that is where you will now need to have that responsibility to nurture yourself in the way that you become a reason through which the others get ignite. Others get ignite because of the spark which you share with them. And that is what they remember. Just remember your past, you know, your teachers who have been the inspiration. It was not the syllabus. It was not the curriculum. It was the abundance in terms of the feeling they gave you. How did they made you feel? What kind of confidence, what kind of faith they had for you? And ultimately, together with education and other tools of learning, they started nurturing the best version in you. And you became the reason through which now the next generation is getting ignited. So we hold great responsibility for our own self and even for the careers and the ladders which our students will be climbing tomorrow. So my context to emotional intelligence is start with yourself. Start with yourself. Know yourself. Identify who you are apart from your titles, apart from this, you know, Dr. Darshana Vitlani with so-and-so degree, with so-and-so, you know, founder, this and that. Who am I actually as a person within? That is something which will create meaning of my life, which will reflect the purpose of my life. So success is not just about what you have accomplished in your life, whatever degree you may have, whatever position may you have. It's not the success. Success is your ability to what you create for others. How do you inspire others? What you contribute in the life of others? That is the true essence of success when we attach the word success to the world of education. Isn't it? Do you agree with this?
Yes, ma'am. But nowadays, the people are giving importance to degree only, not the passion towards the, if we are going to doing any social service also.
Who are these people, Jayanti?
Yeah, most.
Who are these?
I'm Jayanti. I'm Jayanti.
Jayanti, yes. Yes. That is what I'm saying. Yeah. Jayanti, who are these people? These are we individuals. Somewhere, you know, rather than listening to our inner voice, rather than choosing on what we wanted to contribute, you know, the time when I decided to be in the academics, what I had to promise was like, this happened way back when there were three promises, either of the three promises you had to take in your life. One was giving your money, that is donating through money. Second was donating your time. And third was donating your knowledge. That time, like my father, my husband, they are all having their own money. But that time I was just at an initial stage of my career. I could not promise to contribute money. What I could contribute was not even knowledge at that time, because I even felt that, you know, I have that knowledge. I was still, you know, out of my college. It had just been 3 years. What I had was the time. And I decided, I promised myself, I will be making the best utility of time to nurture myself through which I can contribute the knowledge. So again, we have to identify what we want to do rather than what others are doing, what others are expecting. So that inner voice is something which is not there within us. And that is the reason why it is not there even in the students, even in the next generation. So that is where I'm saying that this time, just shift the focus from what is expected from outside to what you want to do really within yourself, what you want to contribute. Right? So I'm taking you through what is emotions as an ultimate way of life. Okay. Since when we get associated to this word emotions in our life? Can anybody say this? What is the time and what is the duration of impact of emotions? Since what time the emotion is associated to us?
From the very beginning of our life.
Okay, so what is the beginning of our life?
Day one, when we born.
is, so I'm reading the words in the chat, that is birth, birth to death.
The first cry what a child makes is the first emotion.
Sorry, the first?
First cry of the child is the first emotion which he carries in the world.
Okay, so what if I tell you that the soul, right, we generally refer to life, we refer to journey of life in terms of life from birth to death, but we hardly take a point of reference that there is a life even after death. Something that is immortal is the energy of soul, isn't it? Right, our Shastra talk about soul, right? Our life is not just limited to this, to this life. Our life has been the replication. What we are today is not just the incidents or the emotions of this life. It has been the emotions of, or the baggages of emotions that we have been carrying as a soul since multiple life. And this is where I want to tell you that emotions is something which is always there as a frequency of soul. Whether you are alive or you are dead. Even in our life, there are times when we experience ourselves, you know, shifting out of the body. These are the experiences you have during the meditation, during some deep introspection activities. My point is, what if I tell you that, the first 3 months of the pregnancy is where a soul that is an emotion body is trying to identify the same frequency from the soul to whom he is going to or she is going to attach for rest of their life after the birth. Generally, within the first three trimester, these are the most three critical period, right, in the women's pregnancy that she undergoes miscarriages. Spiritually, this is said that spiritually, right? You can read this in the pranic healing or other healing books also. It is said that in the first 3 months, the soul is trying to identify. Please mute yourself, whosoever is there. In the first 3 months, the soul is trying to identify the frequency match between the mother and the child who is about to get born. You know, in our Shastras, from the scriptures, you would have seen, you know, whenever God has decided to take birth, they have chosen the right mother. We talk about, you know, Maharana Pratap, Shivaji. Maharana Pratap would have not been Maharana Pratap, Shivaji would have not been Shivaji if they didn't had Jijabai. Right? So it's a lot of things that happens is the frequency of emotion and matching of this frequency of emotions. Right? So as I said in pranic healing, right, we all, right, our body is said as Kama Kosha. Kama means emotions. Kosha means body. Kosha is something which is physical. We all are made of Kama Kosha. In Sanskrit, the astral body, right, is referred as Kama. Kama is nothing but the body of emotion, right? Kama is nothing but the body of emotion. Your desires are, you know, if you have just seen Mahabharata and if you remember the character of this Amba, right, who kills herself, and during the time when she decides to die, she dies with the feeling of revenge, with the feeling of hatred. And when she is born in the next life as Shikhandi, right, she is still living her life with that emotion of hatred. So my dear friends, this emotions has to be rectified in this life, otherwise you will continue to do the same mistake, the wrong mistake of living your life with the worst emotions, which is not meant for the good souls, right? So this is what we are trying to unfold. Kama is the emotions, desire. You need to know them, you need to drop them if they are not right for you, and you need to use your body as an instrument to do the best of the things that you can do in this life, right? So our body is body, soul and spirit, right? So emotions, mind and will, three important aspects of emotional intelligence. This is not there in any books. You may refer any books you want to. These are my life experiences. These are my learnings from my grandparents, right? My parents, my experiences of life through which I'm making this presentation to you. right? You will find nothing derived from any place. Right? So when I talk about the five layers of our body, as I said, five koshas. First is the physical identity in which we invest a lot. You know, we take a good care of this body. How do I look? Right? The kind of apparels, jewelries, gadgets, right? Other things which can make you, you know, we generally feel that this Apple mobile phone, this so-and-so branded purse is my identity, is adding to my identity. Why do you feel so? Because you have not invested a lot in the four inner layers of your personality. If you would have done that, you would have been Abdul Kalam. You would have been Sudha Murthy. You would have been Mother Teresa, who never had any requirement in terms of, you know, coming out with their identity in terms of physical identity. So our physical identity is the part of our existence, the small existence of our part, which is reflected to the outer world. But in the inner world, the mental, emotional, wisdom, and spiritual body, that is the conscious, subconscious, higher conscious, and collective consciousness that we have, is the internalization of our emotional intelligence. Have you heard this? Right? So we are talking about this aspect of emotional intelligence, my friend. We generally understand our life and we always keep this caution to be the caution to be attended at the end, the spiritual caution. We forget that the spiritual caution is the caution with which you turn into the life. Right? Emotional caution, which is very much associated with spiritual caution. The positive emotion experience you have, the higher spiritual awareness you have. I'm repeating myself again. The positive emotion caution you have, the higher spiritual consciousness you will have. In absence of emotional intelligence, you can never achieve the spiritual caution. Right? The reflection of our life, the thing in which our parents and our teachers have been telling us to invest a lot, that has been the intellectual caution, the reasoning, the logic, the IQ. The world is shifting now to EQ, SQ, CQ. Though we refer CQ majorly as a cultural caution, but CQ is basically the character caution. It is the character caution. Social caution. How do you behave outside? Right? We are very good. We are very presentable. We are very nice when we are with people outside. What is it when we are with ourselves? Right? We will go to that in the later phase, and the physical quotient, as I said. Now, whenever we teach our students in this context also, we talk about physical quotient in terms of, you know, beauty, in terms of skin, clarity of skin, beauty, right? Lipstick, makeup. Even this personality makeover classes talks about the external aspect. But we don't talk about physical quotient in terms of health. We don't talk about physical quotient in terms of fitness. We don't talk about this physical quotient in terms of your, physicality, in terms of your strength, what you can pull, right? The very notion of the physical quotient is also very inferior, right? This is my life skill slides, which I'm bringing here, which is a 48 hours curriculum. So I'm not going to get much into it. So this is specially designed for the students. And this is something which I'm running even today, right? So we generally give the weightage, one, to the physical. Two, how we behave in the society. Three, how good we are in terms of intellectual. Four, that is emotional caution. Fifth, oh my God, old days when we will have time, we will think about the spiritual caution. But actually, it is the reverse that has to be taught, right? You have to understand yourself first from the very spirit, very soul. If it is difficult, at least at the level of emotions, then third comes the intellectual caution. Fourth, then comes the social. And fifth is the body, which is going to leave you at any point of time. You never know what is going to be there in terms of your association with your body. You never know that, right? So these are the aspects of life skills, and emotional intelligence is one of the most important life skills. It is not soft skills. It is not soft skills. It is a life skills. And life skills are higher than the technical, than the soft skills. right? This is something which will drive you to the right career and right relationship, the two ultimate goals of our life. Right? So life skills and emotional intelligence matter. So as I said, spiritual caution, right? I'm not going to get much into detail with this slide, but this is I'm keeping for your reference. Okay, so how do you raise your spiritual caution? It is through the power of prayers, right? This is again a 22 hours curriculum. Power of prayers that can help you to ignite your spiritual, aspirations, meditation, rituals, power of your mind, power of your spoken words, power of karma. So this is a journey from soul to self, which comes in the spiritual caution. But we are more restricting ourselves to the emotional caution. And again, here I have one question for you. So the question is emotion leading to thoughts or thoughts are leading to emotions? Can I have an answer for this? Is emotion leading to thoughts or thoughts are leading to emotion? If you have to choose one.
Thoughts lead to emotions.
Okay, thoughts leads to emotion.
I think emotion leads to thought.
Emotion leads to thoughts.
Because sometimes the mood we have, that kind of thought we have. So that is how do you identify
that you are going in the wrong thoughts? Once you check your emotions, right? And the moment you check your emotions, you feel like I'm not feeling good, I'm feeling dull, I'm feeling sad. You try and identify what is the thought going on.
No, I believe it could be depending on the situation. See, you feel you're happy, it would be on the basis of the situation. There you're sad, it could be on the basis of the situation.
Okay. So,
Ma'am, I have another opinion.
Yes, please.
It's like, what are your plannings and decisions or rather targets? And based on the target, if you achieve, end up with the happy emotion. And
drop yourself from the, level of faculty. Even when you were not faculty, you were a small kid. What was affecting you? Was it the thought or it was the emotion?
I feel it is all dependent on the sensory perceptions, what we have from the outside. And how we perceive is again dependent on our own personality. So we may not be able to decide what comes first, thought or emotion.
So that I will clarify today. Yes, Priyanka?
Ma'am, I think that it totally depends on how we have trained our mind.
Framed your mind, okay.
Yes, because if we are always trying to be positive in every aspect of life, we will train our thoughts and emotions into that way only. Even if we are becoming negative, then also we will
try. Who is framing your mind? Because so many of you are saying that it is the situation, external factors. So do they take accountability of framing your mind and emotions, or you want to take the accountability and charge of framing your emotions and thoughts?
It's ourselves. We need to take the accountability.
This is an image of an iceberg, right? What does an iceberg signify? What does an iceberg?
Much of it is hidden, which is not known.
Yes.
And the surface which is looking, it's only 20%, maximum 20% of what is hidden inside.
Yes. So when I talk about the physical quotient, it is the surface yourself which is reflected to the outer world, which is more impacted in terms of your outer personality. There's some disturbance. Please, can you mute? Okay. So the outer aspect of your personality, right, that is your physical caution is reflected outside, right? So rather than taking it as a physical caution, let us take it as your appearance, your body language, and your etiquettes. This is what makes your outer personality, on which we pay a lot of attention. But what is it beneath the water? The 80% of you is something which is always ignored by you, by your parents, by your friends, by the education system, by the society, right? And this is where we have to take the charge now. So the inner personality and the emotions, this is what I'm trying to bring forward now. When we said emotions, right, there were some people who said that emotions precedes thoughts. So a child who is not born, right, starts experiencing multiple thoughts when he reaches to 7 or 8 months in the womb of mother. Before that, the 3 months, post that 3 months. So for first 6 months when the child is in the womb of mother, they're not experiencing any thoughts, but what they're experiencing is the emotions. So the foundation of an individual starts with the emotions. How do you make other feel? Foundation of any relation. Just check any significant relation of your life is how do you feel about the person? So emotions are fundamental. They are foundational to everything that happens in your life. Thoughts is the second stepping stone. And at times when we are not able to identify how am I feeling, I can identify it by checking what I'm thinking. If I'm not able to identify what I'm thinking, I can identify that by understanding how am I feeling. If I'm feeling low, I'm thinking low. Okay? So these are again coined as, two sides of one coin. These are understood as two sides of one coin. If emotions are negative, thoughts will be negative. If thoughts are negative, emotions will be negative. Vice versa. If emotions are positive, thoughts will be positive. Okay, so emotion is the first stepping stone. Is the stepping stone, right, as you as a frequency, you as a vibration. We talk about vibes of people. Right? So these vibes are nothing but emotions, and these triggers your thoughts. Thoughts are something which is rational, which can be communicated. Emotions are difficult to be communicated, and so they are communicated in the language of thoughts. When emotions and thoughts align to each other, right? It is like emotions plus thoughts is equals to mindset. Which is more strong, right? Emotions may be temporary, thoughts may be temporary, but mindset is not temporary. So when the energy of thoughts and emotion gets aligned, it shapes your mindset. And when this mindset becomes firm, it starts shaping your values. So your values are again byproduct of your mindset, of the thoughts, of the emotions. And when these values are repeated again and again, this becomes your belief system, right? So whenever we talk about beliefs, we use the word belief system. System is something which is very enact, right? Say, for example, in school days, when we used to start, writing, right? Just remember the time when you started writing A, B, C, D. Your teacher would have asked you to, she would have drawn an alphabet A and she would have asked you to trace it again and again and again. What does this signify? What does that tracing of alphabet A signifies?
It is getting impressed in our brain, because the brain is an image.
At that time, you were so tender. Okay, you were so tender. So what you were observing at that time when you were making that A, I used to say that, I made a more healthy, a more fatter A than my teacher made. I made it more taller. I made it more bigger, right? She made it a very thin A, but by repeating it again and again, what I'm doing, I'm making it very thick. I'm making it very thick. I'm making it very, dark. I'm making the impression of that A is now not now in that one page, but that impression of alphabet A is now on multiple pages, right? It is seen on the second, third, fourth. That impression is so much, I've put all my energy on that A that it is now imprinted on the other pages also. And this is what happens with thoughts and emotions. If your emotions and thoughts are so strong and you're repeating it again and again and again, it becomes so hard that it affects your other pages of life, your other relations. Getting me? Right? If same emotions and same thought you're repeating again and again, it becomes so thick, so hard that it starts impacting you at personal sphere, at social sphere, at professional sphere, at every place, with everybody. Why? Because the impression is so thick. So whatever emotions you have, whatever thoughts you have, be very, very cautioned in repeating them, because you're creating a belief system out of it. And beliefs are very difficult to break, isn't it? Beliefs are very, very difficult to break. And these beliefs shapes your perception. You start being judgmental. You start perceiving the things, seeing the things in the frame of your glass. If your glasses are red, you feel everybody is, you know, horrifying. If you have green glasses, you start feeling, oh, everything is so positive. Everything is so beautiful. If it is blue, again, you will be a bit doubtful, bit projective, right? So these belief systems are nothing but your glasses through which you perceive the world in a particular way. And this is something which will add on to your attitude, which is again difficult to change. So just imagine, if you want to change your attitude, if you want to change your belief, you have to go downwards climbing the ladders, right? I've made this intentionally a ladder, right? So if you want to change your attitude, you need to change your perception. To change your perception, ultimately you have to come down to the level of emotions. Now, if you see this word behavior, I'm putting it exactly near, the surface, which is now reflected to the people outside. Exactly, right? Now it is appearing outside. So how do you behave is something which is reflected outside and becomes part of your outer personality. It is something which is built on the steps which you have put in the inner personality, but it is now reflecting outside. So your behavior is something people can sense. Your attitude, they cannot. Your perception, they cannot. Your belief, they cannot go deep into you, because you are also not going that much deep for yourself. And then how do you communicate, right? We hold the words like anything, right? We forget everything, but we stick to the words. Oh my God, that day she told me like this. I can never forget those words. So words are also byproducts of what? Our thoughts, our emotions, our beliefs, our perception, right? And based on what we believe, what we perceive, the way we hold the attitude, we communicate, our actions, which are again tangibles. Actions are tangibles. They will start getting appeared to the outer world. So you need to do a lot in the inner world, isn't it? So isn't this the big world we need to work on? Right? So mindset plus thoughts plus emotion is the passion which drives you. So whether people are counting on your degrees, right? I have been through all these experiences where at times, even by holding the degree, right? What passion, what dedication you have used, you have been working is ignored. But you should feel that sense of satisfaction that though nobody is saying this, my heart, my soul, my God is saying this. And this is something which is giving me at most satisfaction than any other titles at my workplace. And this is the noble profession of education, in which always this passion should ignite, should drive us, irrespective of situation, irrespective of students. I have never had an experience of, you know, students not being good. They are of that kind. But, you know, as a child, if your child is not good, having some limitations, will you start complaining on that, or you will start, you know, giving your best so that he improvises? So I've always been on the other side. The notorious students of class, I've always been the class teacher of those students. And at the end of the year, when it comes to result of the class, they have been in the toppers list. So this is what I ignite when it comes to, you know, the student teacher interaction class which we have, right? So it is your inner personality which matters a lot. It is your thought process, your belief system, your perception that matters most, because none of your boss, none of your colleagues, none of those students are going to come back in your life. At the end of your life, you need to have that satisfaction that I gave my best. I contributed to the best of my abilities. And this all starts within. So now let's understand what is the association of emotions and brain. I hope I'm not making you bored, not tired. Should we go ahead?
Sure. Yes, yeah. Ma'am.
Okay, so three aspects of mind. I hope everybody knows about this. Right? Conscious mind, subconscious mind, and unconscious mind. So we use the word IQ, when it comes to our conscious mind. We use the word EQ when it comes to our subconscious mind, and when it comes to unconscious mind, at times we use the word SQ, isn't it? Throughout in our school, in that Ratta Mar practice, right? What we have invested is just the 10% of our mind ability, right? Our conscious mind, the level of IQ, the amount of money we spend in getting the IQ correct, the logic correct, the reasoning correct, is just a 10% of weightage in the holistic approach of our life. So we have been investing in something which was very minimum to be invested. And we were never taught how to invest in something which was the major aspect, the major curriculum of our life, that is our conscious and subconscious mind. Had you had that experience of having that learning, 90% of learning taught to you in the right way? Now people are talking about emotional quotient. Why? Because WHO has taken it as a first 10 skills that a person should have. It is not the first 10, it is the foremost 3 skills which is required for our existence. Required for our existence, not for job, not for being a leader, for our existence. So let's understand this. When we talk about conscious mind, it is a short-term memory. Okay, as I said, Ratta Mar, logic, this plus this is equals to the short-term memory, critical thinking, right? The reasoning, rationalizing, proving why the decision is right, why it is wrong, planning, right? I hope you understand this. I'm not going much more in terms of what is these individual elements, right? But when we talk about subconscious mind, if I just pick up this word, short memory. So what is a short memory and what is a long memory? Okay, just tell me simply, what becomes memory? If I ask you to close your eyes and think of something which immediately comes to your mind, the beautiful memory of your life. Say, for example, this is the word I use. And I tell you, give me some context, some reference to the most beautiful memory of your life. What has it been? Same way, if I tell you, what has been the worst memory of your life? Do you understand that memory is nothing but an incident, it is a past event, definitely. Manasi, it is a past event, but there are so many past events. Why don't we remember everyone? We remember a past event, which is a memory, because there had been some emotions associated and attached to that particular incident. It could be the negative emotion of, sadness. It could have been the best experience of happiness associated with that particular incident. Say, for example, standing right first in the class, and the way, the class teacher and the student had appreciated. So that memory, that day could be my, memory, because happy emotions were attached. So either emotions could be positive or negative, but it becomes your memory. So when I say beautiful memory, you will just think of all positive emotions associated to the incidents, to the past events. But the moment I say worst memory, you will start picking up the incidents with which all negative, humiliated, hatred, jealousy, whatever it could be, negative emotions associated with the events of your life, isn't it? So subconscious mind, which bears this entire emotions, is something which is resulting into the long-term memory, which is the fifth point. Long-term memory, right? So our memories are because of our emotions. Many a times, when we teach in the class, we give some positive, emotion. Like now it is said, I don't know how far it is being practiced in the other institute, but now as I'm into more of training, right? So when we deliver sessions on training, we are always asked to use our statements. With every statement I say, okay, say for example, it is a two-line statement. In that two-line statement, I have to use at least 3 cognitive terms, which has an emotional reflections. so that it is remembered by the person to whom I am imparting the training. Okay, so this is something which is done consciously in a way that it becomes part of your subconscious mind. And this is where we are associating emotions to the curriculum, to everything what is that is to be made learn, that is to be taught. Right, so subconscious minds bear your emotions. They are the reason behind the way you shape your belief system, attitude, values, habits, right? Unconscious, right? It goes from subconscious to unconscious. But the moment you become conscious of your habits, you can change them, isn't it? The moment you realize that, oh my God, I have a habit of eating my nails, the moment you start giving conscious approach to that subconscious thing, right? So that is something which is very important. You have to give that conscious aspect to each of your emotions. The moment you give that focus to every emotions, you will be able to replace them. So if I'm eating my nails and I'm able to give that conscious efforts there, I will be able to stop myself. So every time when I'm getting anger, if I'm consciously able to see that, oh, now I am getting into the anger zone, I can stop myself. So subconscious mind becomes so automated that we need to make it again in control of ourselves. We feel that emotions are not under control. Okay, what I feel is not something in my control, right? So you have to understand what are those buttons. Okay, what are those buttons? When is the anger triggered? When is the humiliation triggered? Right? When is the frustration triggered? You have to understand that, and that is what we will be doing now. Right, but you have to understand that you can start working on your emotions by knowing your habits, by knowing the way, the pattern in which you think, the memories that you have, how many of those memories are to be dropped, the kind of intuitions, how often do you have intuition, how often do you listen to yourself, right? So in Power of Meditation, I generally propagate, we exercise in terms of knowing how to hear your own self, right? How to hear your own self, a self which is not talking through words, but through emotions. So what are those triggers? Say, for example, as a person, if I tell you, well, how do you feel when you become angry? Okay, if I say, how do you feel? Okay, where do you feel when you become humiliated? Where do you feel when you become humiliated? Can anybody answer this? Which point of your body you feel humiliation? Which point of your body you feel anger? Which point of your body you feel shame? Do you know these things? Or should I elaborate?
You can elaborate, ma'am, please.
Okay. Right, so that I will be doing after a while. But this is something that we will be understanding now. Right? Next is power of dreams. How many of you sleep with the diary next to you? Have you ever tried this?
No.
Actually, this slide, I take almost an hour to complete this when it is with, the students or with the trainings which I take, right? Any question you have in your mind, any problem that you feel that you are having in your mind, what to do if you don't have that answer? Just sleep at night with that thought in your mind and give it a positive energy, positive frequency. Keep a book with a pen or keep a diary with a pen next to you. At times it may happen that in between the night, there will be a point of awareness where you will wake up and you will find some answers. At times in the morning when you wake up at 6 or 8 or whatever may be your time, you will find some sense of orientation, solutions that you may start experiencing about it. So it's always advisable to, put all your problems, like you're giving it to God and asking and seeking His, divine vision so that you get the answer to your questions. Okay, so when I was making this presentation, I thought to take it in a very different way. Like I wanted to talk more in terms of NEP, then I thought, let me talk more in terms of educators' practice. But then I thought, majority of us are also missing the self-context to emotional intelligence. So let me go more in the orientation of self-awareness. And that is how this entire presentation got framed. right? So power of dreams, never to be ignored, right? That is the place where there is some divinity which is working for you and who is telling you something. That is the most important words to be taken and written. Willpower is again, like in past, right, in our rituals, in all the religions, huge importance is given to the fasting and this, being awakened throughout night, Jagrata. Why? Because if you control your body, you can control anything in your life. If you can control your hunger, if you can control your sleep, if you can control your thirst, you can control any damn thing in your life. That is the willpower. If you can control physicality, you can control the emotions as well. Okay, so, right, I don't have that time, otherwise I would have gone much in detail to this. Someday, maybe we will interact again. Self-preservation, that is something I will talk in the coming slides, right? And next aspect is unconscious mind. Unconscious is all auto-controlled. See, for example, every day when you go from your work to home, okay, when you go from work to home, you hardly pay that much attention to, when did you use your this hand, when did you use your left hand. You at times feel, okay, ghar aa gaya, I've reached to home, right? So it is so much automated, it is so much auto-controlled that we don't even realize that this is what we have done. So this is where it has gone so deep from your conscious, subconscious to unconscious level that it becomes an automatic aspect. So even when we talk about all this divine people whom we pray today as God, we have their photos in our home, be it Osho or be it Jalaram or be it, anybody, right? We, to all people, all living people whom we pray as God today, they had been into this unconscious mind of power of emotions. They have experienced that. And it had become so auto-controlled that they had gained this experience, this spiritual experience in their life. So, right, one of the thing which is always taught to us whenever we are not able to manage our emotion is to focus on our breathing, right? Whether it is anger, whether it is feel of cry, right, we are always taught to focus on the breath. So this is something which has much to do with your immune system, your internal system, right, with all your chakras. Right, we don't have that time to go with the chakras also, but this is something which is working. Excuse me, miss. Miss Vandana, please mute yourself. Okay, next is spiritual awakening, which again happens at unconscious level, samadhi avastha. Right, if you look into the life journey of Swami Vivekananda, spiritual awakening, even Gautam Buddha, right, all this, right? So again, I'm taking you to that self, right, which is hidden between so many lines, right? So we have to break this shell to get closer to who we are. So now we are moving to the ultimate climax of knowing our emotions and knowing ourselves, right? So how are these emotions associated with our self? Have you ever had this puzzle of identifying who am I? Had it been ever so extreme that you start crying when you think of who am I? What is the purpose of my life? When will I realize that this is the ultimate purpose of my life? When will I have that divine insight that what am I meant for? What do I need to contribute? Does this question come in your mind?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, there are people who have sleepless night even after years of, professional, social accomplishment, all titles, all respect, they still crave to identify who am I. And this is something that you can identify with emotional intelligence. Right? So who are you as a person? Speaks about your personality. External self-awareness and internal self-awareness. So you are what interests you. you are sum total of your knowledge, skills, and competencies. You are sum total of what do you think, what do you value, what do you believe, right? And what is your attitude for everything in your life? How much time do we spend or have we spent in our life to identify what are my core interests? We write about our interest in our SWOT analysis. We talk about our interest when we meet somebody. We talk about our interest in some interviews. But how much personal orientation do we have with these interests? And how do we find that meaningful associations with our interest? Right, we generally assume interest to be our hobbies, isn't it? Something that you like to do. But why do you like to do? What does it bring to you when you are doing that? Right, each knowledge that you seek, like in this 15 years, except statistics, I have taught all the subjects. Right, because every body of knowledge, when I learned, I thought I could blend it in a way that could create much, much meaningful orientation, right? So what things you're seeking to have in terms of knowledge, what things you're seeking to have in terms of skills, like, right, the expectation of corporates, the expectation of our institutes have always asked us to groom for, all this statistical tools, skills, data analysis skills, right? All skills which are more technical in nature, right? Had it ever been an orientation that we are asked to identify the skills which is useful in shaping our own self, right? See, for example, if you approach your institute saying that I want to go for some spiritual inclination programs, how well they will think of sponsoring it. But if you say you want to go for machine learning or any IoT-based programs, you will have easy access to the sponsorship. Right. So how far, these skills, as I said, life skills, these are life skills, right? Very important for your existence. How far has been your inclination to get these skills? Right. So inner personality, we have discussed a lot about this. So who am I? You have to define yourself in personal sphere, in social sphere, and in context to the professional aspect, right? Because whatever you are in personal sphere, you will be reflecting that knowingly, unknowingly in terms of social and professional sphere, right? So I'm saying we need to start with our own self. I need to know myself. That is the biggest thing I have to study. That is the biggest lesson I need to have. I need to know how much do I know about myself. How much do I know about myself? At times, when you take pause and you are asked, ma'am, what is your favorite song? Which is your favorite movie? These days, we even take a lot of time to think about that. Why? Because we have never visited ourselves again. Hum sabko visit karne jaate. On Sunday, we meet everybody, but we hardly have that me time where we visit ourselves. So we are becoming so far from ourselves that we have to take a lot of thinking time to answer anything which is related to ourselves. How well do we regulate ourselves? Okay. How do I regulate myself means how well do I manage myself? What way I regard myself? How do I control myself? How much do you know others? Oh my God, we are spending so much time. We are spending so much time knowing others. What they are thinking about me. Do they like me or not? Am I preferred or not? So and so much. Right. So how much do you know other people and how much other know you? You're more conscious about do they know me well? Right. How much can you control and aid in your relationship with others? We are investing so much in the last two rather than the first two. But trust me, the moment you discover the first two, self-awareness and self-management, rest two will become the byproduct. You will have the social awareness, you will know the people well, you will be able to understand people well, and you will be able to create meaningful relationship with others, provided you know yourself first. Emotional intelligence, right? We need to check that with the ruler. So what is this ruler? This ruler is the simple definition of emotional intelligence. Do I have the ability to recognize my emotions? Do I have the ability to recognize emotions of others? Do I understand these emotions? Do I understand what has caused these emotions to trigger? What are the triggers? What is the consequences of these emotions? Emotions of hatred, emotions of anger, or emotions of compassion, emotions of love. What difference, what impact will it bring? Do I know exactly what emotion is called what? We will have a small test on this. Do you have the ability to label your emotions correctly? Because majority of the time people even fail there. Next is how properly can you express these emotions? So do you have that ability? You know, at times we express our emotions in a way and then we feel that, oh, actually I didn't mean it. I don't know how it reflected like that on my face. Right? Say, for example, before few years, right, whenever I define myself, even today, that is what I do. Whenever I define myself, I say I'm a compassionate educator. So when I use the word compassion, right, I use the warmth, the love, which I have always felt in this, in this role of academician. But always my face is serious. So one such day, one of my senior faculty, he recorded, we were asked to give some record. And he said that, Darshana ma'am, just see your recording. You say you're compassionate and you are actually that, but your face is always so serious. Why don't you smile a lot? And that time, I had this somewhere in my subconscious mind, I had this belief that when you're smiling so much, people take you for granted. People feel that, you don't have much, so, you are very much light. And then actually I realized that when I'm using more smiles and more of that ease in the gesture, it's connecting me even better with the people. So that is where I understood that I have to even express, I have to even check how I'm expressing my emotions, right? So maybe this online classes would have taught this all, right? Videos that we see of ourselves, the recordings, they tell us, how are we expressing ourselves? And then most importantly, how do you control these emotions? Do you regulate these emotions? How do you check on these emotions? And this is what we will be doing now. Okay. So these are the four categories of emotions. How many of you know about them? Sad, glad, mad, scared. Can you just put Mimi in the chat box so that I can know that how much time should I spend on this? Okay. So all of you who are aware, please put me in the chat box. Okay. So I'm not seeing any me. So I assume people are not aware. Okay. So just a second. Okay. So as I said, let us understand. Okay. There are people who are writing me. Okay. So people who have written me. Okay. This question is to you. People who have written me. This question is to you. Okay. Somebody who is writing me, please unmute yourself and tell me what makes you angry. What makes you angry?
When something happens the way you don't expect.
Okay. Something happens the way you don't expect. That makes you angry. Okay.
When someone cheats me.
Okay. When someone cheats me. Okay. Anybody else?
When something is planned and then also it is not going in the proper way.
Okay. When something
when
is planned.
You lose your peace.
Sorry?
When you lose your peace.
Okay, when you lose your peace. Okay, that is a natural outcome.
Ma'am, when someone says no without any proper reason, without giving any proper reason.
Okay, when somebody says no without giving any proper reason. Okay, so I'm just making the list. When you are cheated, when something is not happening as per your expectation or as per your plan. When something you're not getting answer to why people are saying no. Okay. So when people are not explanatory. Now, if I say.
When I'm telling somebody that please do this thing. And although after a lot many reminder, if the people are not doing the thing. So that particular time I got angry.
Okay. So you all are so good as a people, nothing is.
Ma'am.
Yes.
When we want to talk about our feelings or your thoughts, that time you express yourself.
Okay.
You want to share your viewpoints about something to the others.
Even so that sometimes without any reason I got angry. I don't know what is the reason. Uh-huh. That okay. also happens sometimes.
Okay, so majority of you said that whatever you said, right? Everyone, whatever you said, it's all something which is coming from outside. Somebody not matching your expectations, somebody not doing as per plans, somebody cheating you, right? Everything that you said is coming from the external things, right? So we generally feel that emotions are external triggers. It's not something that you feel. You feel it is coming from outside. I am not creating it within me. It is coming from outside. Now, in terms of cheating, in terms of angry, I missed someone's point. Something is not happening, Chalo. Something is not happening as per your the way you planned. So is it making you angry or it is making you frustrated? When you're not able to meet up your deadlines, is it making you angry or it is making you frustrated?
Frustrated.
Okay, yeah. There was some context where the word hurt came, but I just missed one person which I wanted to take in this discussion, that they said they are angry, but actually it was not an emotion of anger, it was emotion of hurt. Cheating is again not an emotion, which cheating is also not, the red zone, that is anger, but it is sadness. When you're cheated upon, you feel you are betrayed. It hurts you like anything. So that is an emotion of sadness. So again, see here, what I'm trying to convey is majority of us, right? Even I put myself in that zone now, though I'm better off to that. But at times, at spontaneous context, it happens that we hardly, have that reference that it is not anger, it is frustration. It is not anger, it is hurt. At times, when people are so angry and they cannot express their anger, they start crying. So we feel when they are crying, they are sad. But actually they are angry, but they are crying. And at other side, there are some people who are so hurt. They feel so sad, but the way they express it is anger. Right? Many a times, when we take a lot of care of our kids and he has done something, he has fallen down, we are so hurt, we feel so sad that my child fell and he has got all this hurt. But we started shouting at him that, dhyan nahi rakhta hai, kya kar raha hai, right? You can't take care of yourself. We start scolding them. And the child feels, ke, my mother is not feeling anything for me. She's so insensitive. Mujhe itna laga hai and she is not even looking after this and she's shouting at me. But what is happening there? It is the sadness. It is the hurt. But the way you are expressing is making that kid vulnerable. And this happens with all our relation. Right? In the relationship of spouse also. At times we are sad, disappointed. But the way we express it comes out as an anger. So we have to be very, very critical in understanding. Am I expressing the right emotion in the right way? Isn't it?
Yes, very nice, ma'am. Yes, agree.
So let us understand this emotions very well. So when I say I'm sad, what does it mean? It means I don't have any life in me. I feel so down. I am sad. I'm sick. I'm bored. I'm feeling very low. I'm feeling very slow. I feel like I'm without any energy. I feel helpless. I feel tired. Isn't it? When I am into mad zone, that is yellow zone, okay? It is where I say I am excited. Okay, say for example, there has been some competition. Say for example, it is one such competition in which I took part last month. It was world's best trainer competition and I was in the top five finalist. I could not make it to the first position. I was super excited because from 400 to 350, from 350 to 2, from 200 to final top, it was a great journey. So in every five rounds, whenever my name was announced, I was like, yes, super excited. And the moment that day didn't even got completed in the night, I was full of anxiety because I was the only person who was from the academic background. Okay, rest all were trainers. And then I felt, you know, I have more of educative way of delivery. I don't have more practical orientation in terms of, you know, the kind of language they have, like Vivek Indra has, the way they modulate their voice and all that. So I lacked those things. So I felt, oh my God, now I'm competing with even more stronger group, this, that. So what happened? From my excitement, I went into anxiousness. The more I came closer to the day of event, what happened? I came more nervous. How will I manage this? And that is where, you know, I went back to my state of emotions. I went back to my body of knowledge. I went back to the things that what I want to contribute. But that clarity came because I was able to manage the emotions well. I was able to foresee that my excitement is getting converted into anxiousness. My anxiousness is getting converted into nervousness. I'm getting frustrated. I'm even shouting at my son for no reason at times, right? So all those confusion, when it got clarity, I became again back to the green zone, where I was able to control myself, where I was able to modify myself, where I was able to read all my emotions well. So I became more focused. But if I would have not managed those emotions, then this frustration would have led to anger. I would have started yelling at people. I would have started throwing the things. I would have become so panic. I would have got some anxiety attacks. I would have been so scared that I would have not even gone for the presentation. Doesn't this happen with us? There is a big day of presentation and we feel, oh my God, it's so difficult to compete with people. I'm not going to participate. I will give some good reason and I will get out of this competition. So I'm so scared, right? So these are the zones. If you don't trap yourself well in yellow zone, you will get into the red zone. And it's very difficult to come back from red to green. It's very difficult to come back from blue to green, right? From yellow, you can come back to green easily. So you have to identify which zone do you spend your maximum time. In Brahma Kumaris, they have this app, you know, Think Me. There they give you I've used just once. They give you some five readers.
Think Right is there.
Think Right. So in five times a day, you have to record your emotions, how you're feeling, five times a day. And they even say, you know, after 1 hour, take a 60-second pause. Right? And this is something which I'm practicing. After every 1 hour, take 60-second pause and try to check what is the state of your emotions. If your emotions are wrong, your thoughts are wrong. Correct both. But if you spend entire day and then at the end, you feel like, you know, committing suicide, you are so much anxious, angry, right? So much disappointed that you don't know now where to start building yourself. You know, you're so shattered. You don't know from where you have to collect yourself. But if you have checked yourself at least five times a day, am I okay? Am I okay? It would have made much difference. It would have made it very easy to, you know, correct yourself when you were just half away wrong, right? So say, for example, if I talk about emotional intelligence, it's like checking whether you're tying your first button well or not. Right? At the end, when you realize you have to open up, you have to rearrange all your buttons. Right? So the point is, check yourself continuously and label your emotions correctly so that you can change it at the right time. Okay, so now the point is, if you are in the blue zone, what you will do? If you are at green zone, what you will do? Right? So I'm just going through this very quickly. If you are in the blue zone, means you are very sad. You feel you are very slow. Then take break. Right? Take break from everything and start gaining yourself. If you're not able to figure out yourself, take support of your friends, somebody you feel who understands you. Do what you like to do. And firstly, be empathetic to yourself. It's okay. You can have those ups and downs, right? Mm-hmm. It's okay. Have that acceptance for yourself, right? So work on your thoughts, work on your emotions. That is what you have to do when you're in blue zone. When you are in red zone, right, withdraw yourself. Otherwise, you will be the biggest danger to yourself as well as to others. when you are in red zone, withdraw yourself, don't do anything, just sit with yourself, observe your breathing, try to calm down yourself, otherwise you will hurt yourself as well as the others. Right? Practice self-control. See to it that your emotions are not controlling you. You have to control your emotions. Don't give that power to your emotion that they control you. Let go, release those emotions. Right? You would have done some anger management class. For every emotions, we need to have different practices. Right? Focus on your body. You know, where? So I was just talking about, where do you feel the emotion of guilt? Where do you feel the emotion of, humiliation? We feel it here. When we are not able to express. So at times, when we take emotional intelligence with kids, we ask them that when mama scold you, where do you feel? So at times he will say, I feel it here. At times he will say, I'm feeling it here. At times he say, I'm feeling it here. So at times when he say, I'm feeling it here, means he's very scared of mama. When he feels he's feeling it here, he feels like, mera dimag bhi phat jayega. So he is trying to say that her anger is adding to my anger. And when he says it is feeling me here, it means that he want to explain himself, but he's not able to explain. So it is creating sadness. So you have to understand, next time, whenever you have any emotional trauma, just try to identify where are you feeling your emotions? Which are the buttons? Right? Is it on your back, on your shoulder, on your head, on your neck? Where are you feeling this? In your stomach, right? So that is where you're getting more scared. Okay? Where are you feeling these emotions? In yellow zone when you are, means you are in excited, nervous, mixed feeling, right? So, when people get nervous, what do? They start walking, they start jumping, they start, they express it more with the body. Right? Sadness, people rarely express it through body, but yellow and red zone, people express it through body. Right? So use your body energy in some good things. Otherwise, you will get into the red zone. Right? You will start beating yourself, hurting your hand on the wall. Right? So it's better go on walk. Take deep breaths. Right? Get clarity. Right? If you are so much confused, get some clarity. Right, so before you get into blue or red zone, right, from yellow you can go to blue, you can go to red. If you don't control your emotions well, right, then red zone. If you are suppressing your emotions, you will get into the blue zone. So this is a time where you have to use your body energy so that it is not getting at least in the red zone, right? And when you are in green zone and something good is happening, be very positive, and when you're positive, start new things or complete the things which you have piled up. Because you are in happy mood, you are in good mood, you will be able to do that work very quickly. So in green zone, just try to start something new or complete what was pending. Empathize with other, because your good mood will make their mood better, right? Red zone, as I said, withdraw yourself. Don't go and meet anybody. Otherwise, your bad mood will trigger bad moods of others, right? Move with your gut feeling, because when you're happy, right, your gut feeling, your intuition works best. Self-awareness, this three important aspects I would be taking now, right? So I hope we are clear with identifying our emotions, knowing our emotions, what is to be done when we are in these zones. Did it brought any new context to you from the people who said that they know about this zone? I hope, right? Okay, so now we move on to the next, and that is about the self-awareness. Can anybody tell me from what level self-awareness starts? From what level self-awareness starts? It starts with identifying the missing aspect of you. Okay? Right? It starts with the missing aspect of you. And who is going to find it out for you? Who is going to find it out for you?
Ourself.
Why? Because if we will not do it to ourselves, right? We are finding it. Please mute yourself. We are finding it so difficult. to be with ourselves, do you think anybody else will be able to do this for you? Nobody is going to invest in you. Trust me. Right? It's you who hold this responsibility. It's you who is important to you. Please make sure that you are important to yourself. Nobody else is going to find out the missing piece of you, because only you know yourself the most. Though we have that habit of, you know, trying out new clothes, new things, and going out and seeking confirmation and validation from others. How am I looking in this dress? You have a mirror. You know your body. Can't you make this decision for yourself? Whether this dress is suiting you or not? Is it suiting your profession, your body type, XYZ? But we are so much used to getting validation from others that we even put this responsibility of knowing ourselves from others. I have students, I have mentees who come and say, ma'am, please, mere bare mein kuch batao na. Ma'am, aapko mujhe, aap mujhko mujhse bhi zyada jante. You tell me something about me. Right? You have to know your self-will, right? What others will tell about you could be some judgments, could be some observation. It could not be the totality of you. That is what you have to do. Right? So it starts when you open yourself to visit yourself. It starts when you open yourself to visit your open self. Many a times we ourselves hide so many things from ourselves. Right? At times when I feel I'm jealous, I will say, no, I'm not jealous. It's just that like this. We are not being honest. We are not being truthful to ourselves. Right? So firstly, you have to acknowledge whatever you are feeling. You have to be open to see the things as it is. It can be good. It can be bad. But until and unless you don't see it as it is, you don't acknowledge it as it is, you'll not be able to change it. Right? You cannot change anything until and unless you accept them as it is. Right? To change anything, you have to have that acceptance. That acceptance will give you the power to start working on changing the things. Okay? So openness towards yourself, being honest to yourself, having that integrity with yourself is most important when it comes to self-awareness. You need to monitor yourself. You need to check on yourself. You need to check on everything, be it your emotions, be it your thoughts, be it the way you see the things, be it the way you judge the things, everything and anything. You have to monitor yourself. Please spare that time for yourself. Please spare that time for yourself. And when you monitor yourself, you will identify these three important aspects that you need to validate when you monitor yourself. The very first one is condition of worth. So what do you mean by condition of worth? Can anybody explain this word to me? What is condition of worth? Condition of worth is basically the precondition through which, you know, you are nurtured. Condition of worth is like, if you do this, you will get this. If you don't do this, you will not get this, right? If you do this, mama will love you. If you will not do this, mama will not love you. If you do this, boss will promote you. If you don't do this, boss will not promote you. It happens in terms of the duties and obligations, but there are again different aspects in terms of emotions associated to that. So everything that we do, right, anything which we judge, we check, we always find out some predetermined set of standards. Okay, whenever you go for quality check, there is a checklist, right? So even when we check ourselves, when we monitor ourselves, we have this preconditions, condition of worth. So if I honestly accept that I'm jealous, if I honestly accept that this is this, oh my God, how people will feel about me. They will not trust me, right? I am not proving myself as a good friend. There can be so many things. So these conditions will not allow you to have that openness to yourself. So there are some conditions that you have to shed off. And you have to find that even if you accept yourself, people don't feel worth of you, you should appreciate that openness of yourself. Right? So that is where we use the word condition of worth. Next is introjected values. Introjected values are values which are not yours. These values are given to you, are forced on you by somebody else whom you thought to be superior than you. Could be your parents, could be your teachers, could be society, could be anything. But somewhere deep down in your heart, you have never accepted those values. So whenever you monitor yourself with your set of values, you can use this introjected values to validate, to cross-check. But don't make that introjected values as yardstick to measure you. Right? Don't make those introjected values as yardstick to validate yourself. Know yourself, know your emotions, know your values. And ultimately, what you aspire to do has to be at the center. Your values has to be at the center. Say, for example, in one of the articles from Tata, right, Ratan Tata said that always at top condition, top management, or there are so many instances in my life where I have been at top, but alone because of my values. I have been at top, but alone. I have experienced a deep vacuum just because of my values. But I was still okay with that because I know my values were more stronger than the values which was expected outside, behavior which was expected outside. So that is how you have to monitor yourself. And next is locus of evaluation. Locus of evaluation means the center of evaluation, right? So what is being evaluated and how is being evaluated? So control in the process of evaluation. So there is internal locus of control and there is external locus of control as well. Right, so you use all these tools to monitor your self-will, right? You have to identify what aspect of your personality you have to investigate, you have to evaluate, right? If you look into the personality archives, there are 12 personality archives. So which personality, like in each of us, there are these 12 aspects of personality. So each of these aspects is to be evaluated. Okay, next is introspection. Whatever you have evaluated, you have identified, now introspect. Why it is, how it is, when did this came, when did this went? Some values which were very, very, very crucial to you. Say, for example, honesty. Now you are no more honest. Why? Because of your job roles. You may blame your job, saying that, you know, if I would have been honest, I would have not got all these promotions. Right? So what good things went off? What good things went off and what vacuum it has left in you? What bad things, what bad emotions, what bad virtues or bad values you have gathered, which is not serving to you, right? Everything does not fit to everybody. So introspect and identify what is to be kept and what is to be removed. And with the integrity, clear what is not required and hold on what is required. This is where you discover self-awareness. Bit difficult, but needs to be practiced. You need to know yourself. You need to have knowledge of yourself. Otherwise, everything that you will do in your life, at one state you will feel everything, like you feel a vacuum. You don't feel satisfied within. Okay, you will be constantly craving for something because there is something in you which is not integrated well in yourself. Right? So this is a journey of self-discovery which starts with you. And emotional intelligence, the first step, the first level is self-awareness. Next, self-regards. How are you with yourself? How much good friend you are to yourself? How much you are a devil-like person, constantly hurting yourself? I had been this to myself for long, long, long years. Very long years. Very long years. Right? So, how do you regard yourself sets the tone of everybody, others, the way they will regard you. So, if you feel you are worthless, if you feel you are not good enough, everybody around you will come and validate the same thing that you propagate to yourself. So what is the tone with which you talk to yourself? What is the relation that you have established with yourself? Are you your friend or you are your own enemy? That is what we say. How do you regard to yourself? How do you talk to yourself? Self-regard is very, very, very important. Very important. Right? And this is, again, never taught to us. How should we talk to ourselves? Right? None of the education, none of the upbringing, none of the parenting tool has ever taught us how to talk with ourselves. Right? At times, I feel that pity on the education, on the curriculum we have. Most important lessons which we need to live an ideal life is not taught to us. Right? So how do we regard ourselves? We need to regard ourselves with utmost confidence in ourselves. Right? We need to validate ourselves about what we are, who we are, how we are. And this is something that should bring more confidence to what we are. Even if it is not giving us profit, even if it is not giving us position, even if it is not giving us more people to enjoy with, it's okay. Confidence is not just about syllabus or exam or workplace or presentation. It is something which is power of your soul. Right? Confidence is not the casual word which we use in our day-to-day life. Right? So how do you regard yourself? If you have faith in yourself, it is reflected with your confidence. Right? There are so many classes, right, curriculums which happens when it comes to self-confidence. Boost your self-confidence. It is never boosted by anybody else. It has to be boosted by yourself. When you start working on yourself, then only you will be able to have access to this power in you, which is in the name of confidence. And this comes when you respect yourself, when you respect the uniqueness of yourself, when you respect your own values, your own thoughts, your own beliefs. Right? If you don't do this to yourself, mind it, nobody else is going to do it to you. Right? So self-respect is something which is very important. This is the food to the soul. If you don't respect yourself, you deteriorate your soul. Right? You're not just deteriorating your life or your reflection in the life in various relations with, at various places, but you're deteriorating the energy and the power of your soul. How optimistic you are, how positive you are, right? Try and find out, seek out every opportunity that makes you positive. Continuously, you have to check yourself and you have to push yourself into green zone, right? Make this elaborate, deliberate exercise that you keep yourself most in the green zone. And this happens when you are always trying to seek out some positivity in every negative things that may happen, right? Say, for example, we say that Duryodhan, right, the most negative character of Mahabharata. But again, one positive aspect of that Duryodhan was, when we talk about friendship, we talk about Duryodhan and current friendship, right? Again, there are so many other contexts to that. But again, right, having that ability to find out one positive thing can also put you into the green zone. Independence. Now, when I say independence, it is not the physical independence, not the independence in terms of decision power that you can take, like I am independent to take my decisions. No, it is independence of not getting attached to the expectation of others. Like somebody said, you know, when my expectation is not fulfilled or I don't meet to an expectation of somebody, self-respect or confidence sometimes creates, okay, yeah. Okay, so when I talk about independence, independence is not about decision making, but independence is again like, irrespective of what you feel, I have my own truth. Even if that truth is not pleasing you, I'm sorry, this is my truth. I respect that truth. Right? So I don't have to be dependent in terms of seeking approval. That can be emotional approval also. Right? So others' validation should not hammer me or should not deteriorate me. I have to be open to understand what are my problems, what are my limitations. So I'm talking about confidence. I'm not talking about overconfidence. I'm talking about self-respect. I'm not talking about harming somebody else's interest. Okay, so please don't get it wrong. Next is motivation. If everything around you has stopped, is not working, is not good, right? You yourself can ignite yourself to a level that you again bloom up as a flower, right? Every day, right? Every morning, right? In spite of all dirt, lotus tends to come out blooming as a beautiful flower, a flower which is referred as flower of God, on which God sits and decides, right? So in spite of being in that dirt, it has its own purity. So this purity is purity of motivation. So that purity has to be there in you always. And that is the reason why I've kept this self-regard. This entire, the reflection of it is in the form of lotus, right? So this is what I'm trying to symbolize, that you have to be lotus. You have to know your worth. What do you stand for? And have to be always optimist. And firstly, regard yourself with utmost dignity. That is what you have to do to yourself. And the next and important, self-control. What is impulse control? Right, impulse is something which is very spontaneous. At times, we don't even realize. Right, say for example, you throw a stone on dog, he will immediately bark. Okay, you take a stone and you throw it on a dog, he will immediately bark. It is an impulse behavior. And doesn't this happen with the human beings? You abuse me, I will immediately start shouting. Right? Is it important that I need to answer for all the abuses people have for me, for all the questions people have for me, right? In context to abuses also we say, right, it is your choice whether you should take it or not, right? So self-control is whatever may be the triggers, even it may be the delay in the project, not meeting the schedule on time, right? Anything, right? People cheating on you. Those are the triggers, but how far you will be accepting those triggers, or you will be having that filter, right? We all would be having that filter for drinking water in our home, right? So do we have those filters around us? Why are we always open to, receive everything that comes out? Right? Why should we be so fragile that we receive everything the way it comes to us? Why can't we have the filters which can reduce the degree, the impact which it may have on us? With context to emotional intelligence, again, one thing which I would like to say is emotional intelligence is basically a filter. This intelligence is a filter, where you filter all things which is not suitable to you for your life, for your soul, for your spirit, for your mind. Filter those things, shed it off there, right? Accept only the things which is important to you, better for your intake, better for your mental, physical health, right? We don't need to have those impulses directly coming and affecting us. We can prepare the shield of protection, right, as we do it on our window, so that mosquitoes does not come. We can have it for our own emotions, so that we are not that easy to approach, right? So that is an immune system, emotional immune system that we have to develop. Second, stress tolerance. Understand the point beyond which you cannot tolerate. Let go the things, but don't affect your emotional health, because your emotional health will start deteriorating your physical and spiritual health, right? Delayed gratification. As I'm not having much time, so I'm not asking the audience, right? Presuming that majority of you don't practice it, I'm explaining this word to you. This is what majority of us do. Delayed gratification. Delayed gratification is when we get something which we didn't expect it, right? Something we feel, oh my God, I never expected. Say for example, if I talk about this, Atal FDP, Dipti ma'am, who was the first speaker, 6 or 7 years, when I thought of writing some articles, I had referred so many of her articles. One of the speaker who was there on the last day, Dr. Subhash Sharma, Indian Ethos, my entire inclination to that subject came from reading his articles. The speaker who was there earlier to me, I had visited his online portal of his emotional intelligence workshop. So when I saw all this name on the same piece of paper, Margi ma'am, who was again one of the speakers, she came in 2008 or 9 in one of the institute where I used to study, I used to teach, and it was just my first year. So I just loved her aura, her vibes. So all those people, now I'm sharing stage with them. So it was such a great feel that, people whom I have been reading, whom I have been knowing, I'm sharing the stage with them. And that is the first thing that I did, that thank you, God, for equipping me with all this, that I'm able to come forward with these sessions in such an interesting way that, I'm seeing your messages and your participation, and I'm feeling super excited to be here. So this is where I talk about delayed gratification. Don't delay any gratification, because every gratification which you delay puts you in yellow and blue zone. If you gratify, if you acknowledge, if you feel the bliss of the things, it will put you directly in the green zone. Right? So don't delay any gratification. This gratification will help you to absorb shocks. Anything bad if happens in your life, you can visit the good things which happened to you. And as you have recorded that good things, okay, so I've recorded the good things happened to me in the name of gratitude. Okay, I've thanked God, I've thanked those people who have helped me. So whenever something wrong happens, some wrong person, I get into some wrong situations, I again revisit, okay, this is one wrong situation, this is the one wrong person I've met. But these are number of people who are so good. These were the number of situations which were so favorable. So I am able to control the negative by my positive. I hope you are able to get this. Right? Don't delay the gratification. Don't delay the gratification. It is acknowledgement. So anything bad, whenever it will happen to you, you will be able to cover it. You will be able to wrap it up with the good things that you have. So, no delay gratifications, okay? Emotional stability, right? Gratitude will make you more stable. Gratitude will make you more stable. Please mute yourself. Somebody is unmuted. There's some noise. Yes, thank you. And next is resilience. Resilience can be almost a 3-hour talk, right? But I hope you understand the words. Resilience is very important, right? So, again, revisiting your own silence to hear the new knowledge, right? Revisiting yourself to get something which is lying in you, which has to reach you, right? So give that time, give that pause to yourself, that you go back to yourself. You go back to yourself where there is you and yourself, nobody else, and there can be a clear communication. So this communication will again help you to be grounded. So emotional intelligence makes you grounded. Yes, Hina? Dr. Hina?
Yes. Hello, ma'am. The session is really very fantastic. One question I have is that, see, sometimes when we are talking about career development and all, the delayed gratification which you are talking about, this sense is showing the gratitude. Whereas in a career development, we talk that delayed the gratification, don't just jump on that success if you want to achieve a big goal, delayed the gratification. So these are the two ideas which are conflicting, I think, But however, I am aware that you are talking about this in the sense of showing the gratitude. And when we talk in the sense of success, we talk that delayed gratification. Don't just jump on to, celebrate the small success and go for the another milestone. So can you just elaborate on it?
You're right, right? Generally, in the logical terms, when we apply this word delayed gratification, we tend to have that calmness so that, we are still not settled here. Okay, there is another leap which we can take to get into even more higher, even more bigger stage. But trust me, if you don't pause and if you don't acknowledge what you have achieved, the strength to take the big leap which is required, right, you will never ever have that. So when it comes to self-regards, there was the word motivation. So this gratitude will help you to motivate yourself, will motivate yourself to take that bigger leap. And again, when you take that, you will be still grounded. Why? Because you know that this is happening with sheer hard work, with all good intentions, with some purposes, that you are shifting yourself from one level to another, from this level to another. Right? So you are right in your own way, right? But the context is that if you don't acknowledge, like I had never acknowledged my success. Say, for example, if I talk about getting selected in the second batch of SEBI's financial educator. So that time, what happened? I felt, one by one, every achievements which I had, like last year, I was with IIM Bangalore. My venture was incubated there. So out of 11,000 women, getting a certificate of top 100 performing venture was something I need to actually stop and pause and say thanks. Right, that led me to get associated as trust member with various other foundations coming here. Right, so my point is, so this delayed gratification, I feel it is not to be delayed. Right, so
understood your point, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Right, so when I talk about emotions again, what is important is to manage these emotions. So emotions which are negative, that is denial, anxiety, shock, resistance, fear, anger, right? When it is explored, when you understand those things, Amit, I'm just coming to you, huh? Give me just some time to complete this. So when I manage these fears, right, I am exploring a new beginning to understand this fear, the reason why they have came up in my life, how did they enter in my life? What incidents, what memories have made these emotions stick in my life? The moment I realize this, right, I take a transition. I take a transition, I decide, I make a choice. No, I'm not going to live with these emotions. These are my emotions. I'm definitely going to change these emotions because I don't want them anymore in my life. They are not serving my life purpose. So try out the future possibilities of changing these emotions, replacing these emotions with acceptance. Accept that you had fear. Accept that you were angry. Accept that you were confused. Now what you can have is, be patient, be creative, be hopeful. Energize yourself to the new limit of enthusiasm and be productive enough to achieve whatever you want to achieve. So managing change is possible only when you manage all these emotions, right? So you need to reorient the entire psychology of your emotions, all the events which were not fruitful and you have held that in your mind because of emotions, release the emotion that memory will release. The moment you release the emotion, the memory will release, and the memory when it is released, you will have free space. Now that space is empty, you can create a new reality. You can create a new experience. You can create a better memory. But provided you throw the unrequired, unproductive, useless memories which you have held because you gave that memories a place with the emotions. Replace the emotions and manage the change that is much required to experience new event, new people, new situations in your life. Right? So where do you see yourself always? If you see yourself focused, or whether you see yourself as not focused, if you see yourself focused on yourself, right? Okay. If you see yourself not focused on yourself, neither focusing on others, right? So there are two contexts to emotional intelligence. So this is a larger part which I have not taken in this particular 2 hours because I wanted you to be more aligned to yourself first. Then someday in future, if we get chance, we'll come and we will interact on this, that what is self-awareness and social awareness. So what is about yourself and what is about others? So if you have that association right with yourself, you will have it right with the others. But if you don't have it with yourself, with others also, you will not have it with. So you will become a person who is careless, right? If you are focusing more on others and less on yourself, you become comparative. You will continuously compare yourself thinking, oh my God, see what they have in terms of the things, the people, the opportunities, the post, the positions. You will continuously compare yourself. Again, both of these energies are deteriorating emotions. Comparison is again not a positive emotion. It will take you to anxiety, anxiousness. It will make you scared. It will give you fear. It will make your temperament go beyond your control. Right? But when you focus on yourself and you're able to know yourself, you will have more compassion of yourself. You will be happy within yourself. And when you focus on yourself and you are also able to focus on others, you will be able to take up the roles, responsibilities, something that will come so instinctively from you that you will become committed, you will become responsible for so many things. As I said, you know, education, being an academician is something which is a commitment. And this commitment is coming out beautifully when, you know, you focus on yourself, your self-awareness, and you also know the awareness, the people with whom you are working, whom you are dealing, right? You will be able to bring much harmony in your act. And this will make you more committed, more responsible. Right? So again, two aspects. When you know who am I and what do I do, right? You fall into two sphere of awareness. One, you know yourself well. You're higher inside of your self-awareness, but you don't know how you're perceived by others. External self-awareness is low, okay? So when there is low internal self-awareness and low external self-awareness, you don't know who you are, neither anybody else is telling you who you are. What happens then, right? Don't know who they are and what they do, what they stand for. Don't know what other things about them. So I don't know. So I'm trying to always seek out the answers. And in this process of seeking out answer, I become so frustrated that I'm not able to perform. I'm not able to give my best. I'm not good in anything, neither in terms of relationship, because I'm always seeking from others. I'm not having it within me. If I'm very low in self-awareness and very high in external awareness, I know others well, but I don't know myself well. What I will do? If I know others well, I will try to please them. I will try to butter them. So what will happen here? Right? My focus will appear more to the others. And in this, I will always overlook myself. Right? And in this act of overlooking myself to others, I will not be important because I'm not important to myself. So whatever others say, I will always say yes, yes, yes. And this is where I become a pleaser, which is again a not good choice, not good place to be. So over a time, they too make a choice that aren't services of their own success and fulfillment. Means I'm not my own accomplishment. Whatever they are accomplishing, right? I'm trying to enjoy myself, seeing their success, helping them, right? Because I don't know what I want to have in my life. Introspector is where I know myself well, but how I'm appearing to others, I don't know. So I want to know myself completely. And I want to remove this blind spot from, you know, what is hidden, what is unknown to me. So in Johari window, we have this, you know, blind spot, unknown self. So if I want to increase my complete awareness, I need to know myself first, and then I need to seek awareness from others. So when I know what people think about me, and I already know what I am, I will be able to have full control of my life, right? I will be able to have full control of my life. I will be able to accomplish everything and anything which I want to do because my values are aligned to what others are also expecting. I will become a very good leader in whatever field I am because I know I'm able to lead myself, so I will be able to lead others as well. Okay, so this is where I map internal and external self-awareness. So I have to be motivated to know myself, right? Curious, as we are curious to know about film stars, celebrities, sports stars, aren't we? So we have to have that curiosity and excitement to know about ourselves. give that time to ourselves, choose ourselves, and give the best possible experience, emotions to ourselves. Right? So self-awareness, right? As I said, I'm not touched this part. I'm just completing this, stating that self-awareness is where you know your vision, your values, your belief, and all that stairs which we have taken in that iceberg image. If I know myself well, I will be able to manage myself well. I will be able to decrease the stress. I will be able to increase my satisfaction, fulfillment. Okay. I will feel more abundant. I will be self-actualizing myself. I will be empowered within. And I will have increased resilience. If I know others, I will have better understanding with them. I will be able to accept them well. I will be having better relationship with them. We will be able to build better rapport. There will be a win-win situations, right? So there will be meaningful association, meaningful relation, which will create some effective workplace or other orientations, right? So when I know myself and what do I do, and when I know my personal competency and social competencies, right, from personal, right, I get associated in strong interpersonal relationship through which whenever I have to perform in a team also, I'm able to perform at my best, right? So self-awareness, social awareness, and empathy together will create beautiful bond of relationship. I will be inclusive. There will be equity among us. There will be belongingness for each other. Why? Because I accept myself. I accept you because I empathize with you. And this will give harmony in the relationship. Right? Emotional intelligence, right? Whatever we may talk about artificial intelligence, right? Artificial intelligence, if I define it in a simple way, it is human intelligence transformed in a mechanical way to some systems and robots, right? So without emotional intelligence, there is no human intelligence. Without human intelligence, you can never understand the cultural aspect or sensitivity to the culture, especially in this cross-border approach, right? The briefcase of life starts with what you have to feed the first thing in the briefcase: self-awareness, acceptance to yourself, give power to yourself, regard yourself high with best things, have that respect for yourself, be adaptable, strong enough to change if something is wrong in you, something is wrong with you, right? Have that power to change. If you accomplish all these five skills, self-awareness, acceptance, power, esteem, and adaptability, you will be able to create livelihood skills, relationship, better earning opportunities, that is money management skills and employability skills, right? So fundamental skills to all these life skills is the emotional intelligence, right? So this is what I wanted to offer, and this is what I wanted to bring through my presentation. Thank you so much for being there, patiently listening to me. And Amita, can we have your question?
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, yeah, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this wonderful session. I thought I found my answer in the social intelligence, awareness about the social environment. And I put myself in the category of the seeker. I don't know what others think about me. And if
Amita, I'm so happy. I'm so happy that in spite of knowing that it is low in both the end, you have that courage, you have that power to openly accept that you fall into the category of seeker. And trust me, majority of us have been into that category of seeker, but very few have that strength to express that I am into seeker and I don't want to be there anymore.
Thank you, ma'am. But I don't put that courage ki if I kisi se mujhe ek bar disappointment mila hai to main fir samne se use reach nahi kar pati hu ki bhai use jaake main samne se bulaun ya agar mere ko ek bar negative feelings aayi hai unki aur se ya kuch bhi ignorance bhi mila hai to I don't have a courage to reach them firstly. So for that, what I have to do?
Okay. So should I first unshare my screen in case if you want to take the snapshot to be, yes, you can just take a snapshot and I will just unshare my screen so that we can just take one-on-one questions in case if you have anything.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm just closing the screen. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So what you can do, right? So there you indirectly try to say that you are a person who cannot forgive others easily.
Yeah.
I had experienced major forgiveness when I was pregnant. And the time when I gave birth to my child, I thought I don't want to keep any space for anybody in my life, for any situation in my life, right? I just want to create the best things in the shelf of my mind, okay? So mind frame which we have, let us put all the positive experience, positive things, and that we can have once we start practicing forgiveness, which is again one of the important emotional intelligence skills, right? So again, how you will be able to forgive the person, when you will be able to forgive the person, it depends a lot in terms of the experience that you had with the person. What was that incident? What was the event? What are the probability of that event occurring in the future? So many things are associated to that, right? So I will be able to answer you only clearly once I know that situation well. So I'm sorry to, you know, rounding off this question in this way. You have my number in case if you want, we can talk personally also.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes. Anyone else would like to ask anything?
We are getting very good comments in the chat box. Thank you, ma'am, for your wonderful session.
Thank you.
Any participants, they are having any questions. So our expert is with us. You can directly ask your questions with us. Okay, so if we are not having any questions, so we may end today's session.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Darshana, ma'am, can you please share your screen one more time? I was so busy listening to you, I forgot to have the, you know, a snapshot of the scene.
Okay, just a second. I'm just sharing.
Thank you.
Yeah, so here it is. So I hope and I expect that each of you will at least try to discover this relation with yourself, right? That was the ultimate purpose with which I took this presentation in so much internalized approach. I could have talked about how we can have, you know, deviate from emotional intelligence to cultural intelligence. So many of those contexts could have come, but I just thought of, you know, having it first for ourselves so that when our cups are filled, we can pour it in some other cups. Right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Welcome. Any questions if you have, I can definitely, you know, take them into consideration. Right. In case if you're hesitant, you can always mail me. You can message me. Thank you. Yes, Rachita.
So kind because they are with us since morning.
And morning, the way the internet was fluctuating, I told Sarika, ma'am, you tell them that I'm not going to talk about any theory. I'm going to talk about everything which is practical, applied, you know, applied EQ, so that they come back. I was really worried whether they will be coming back at 2:30 or not.
That's why I'm saying participants are very kind.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much to all the participants. It was a great experience even for us to have all of you with us full day. And we are waiting for a wonderful sessions which we are going to conduct for next 4 days. So hope to see you again. Thank you all.
Thank you.
So I have just shared the all three sessions link into the WhatsApp group also and into the chat box also. So for today, you may fill the attendance or like we can say the feedback link. It's mandatory for all the participants because we need to submit it into the Atal portal. And we will try to continue tomorrow onto the Google Meet only. In case any change be with us, and just support us like today you all did. Thank you so much. We are just winding the session. Thank you, Darshana ma'am. Thank you all the participants. See you tomorrow at 9:30 sharp with our another expert. And thank you. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.